We have with us Lieutenant General Rajender Singh, former Director General of Indian Infantry, which is the largest arm of Indian Army. He has also been awarded. After his retirement in 2009, he has worked with DLF Foundation as its CEO. Working as the CEO of DLF Foundation, he has been awarded with various civilian honors that included a Lifetime Achievement Award as well as a Distinguished Award that were awarded by ICCA as well as ABP News. We'll be speaking to him to know about the achievements of Modi government, the things that are happening in India in terms of the civilians as well as the decisions that have been taken concerning the army and the armed forces. So welcome to 10 News. So talking about the 4 years of Modi government, how do you see everything that has transpired in last 4 years from 2014 to now?
जहाँ तक Modi government का सवाल है, I find that when Modi came to power, there was tremendous amount of euphoria, hope, and everybody felt that the country is going to now launch into a kind of a progress path which has not been seen earlier. The performance over last 4 years has seen a large number of those aspirations coming true. However, equally important is that there are also equally number of large aspirations which have not come true. As far as the achievements of Modi government is concerned, the way I look at it, his greatest achievement is his personal honesty and that image that he has, that he wishes well for the country. He tries to work hard to achieve those objectives that he has set for himself. He also has retained his image of absolute honesty. And these are some of the pluses which one can see as far as Modi as a person is concerned. Now, as far as the performance of his government is concerned, I feel that his greatest achievement has been in the field of external affairs. Our image in the world has really gone up. We have also been able to establish a place for ourselves in Committee of Nations. We have also made great strides as far as our improvement of relations with a large number of countries is concerned. Our relations with the United States has improved tremendously. Our relations with a large number of African and Southeast Asian countries has improved. We have really established ourselves as one of the nations which cannot be ignored. And that is, I think, a great achievement. As far as our relationship with our neighbors is concerned, the performance has been mixed. Whereas our relationship with Maldives and some other neighbors has not been to our expectations. Our relations with China, after an initial hiccup, has now come on an even keel. I think in an overall perspective, Modi has done a wonderful job as far as projecting India's image is concerned. About his achievements in other fields, there have been a number of other achievements. Though Modi has not shied away from trying out new things. He has launched a number of initiatives. Some of them have succeeded, some have not. He has his performance of his government in the field of transportation, in the field of building roads, in the field of power sector, and all has been extraordinary and is very good. However, his performance as far as economic field is concerned, I think leaves a scope for improvement. Some of his decisions, though, were path-breaking, like demonetization, etc., have not really fulfilled the kind of expectations that was felt that these moves will bring. However, that notwithstanding, the economy has generally held. It should have grown at a faster pace, but at the pace at which it is growing even now is not bad. The field in which I think Modi government has not really come up to the expectations of people is that despite its often repeated motive of sabka saath, sabka vikas, I think they have not really come up to the expectations of large section of our society. Their treatment of Dalits, or that is the perception which a large number of or large population of this country has, their encouraging or even if not encouraging, not stopping this so-called cow vigilantes, has really done a tremendous amount of damage to Modi government's credibility. I feel that nobody is questioning their overall philosophy of promoting Hindutva. If this party wants to promote Hindutva, let the people of the country decide whether it is good or bad for them. But what the people would certainly not want is that a section of the people of this country are discriminated against. What the people will not want is that in the garb of Hindutva, certain fringe elements take prominence, which will ruin the reputation of this wonderful work that Modi government has been doing. I think this has been their greatest folly. Their second greatest folly is that there has been a perception that the Modi government and Modi personally has been slightly arrogant, and he has surrounded himself with the people who hold a particular type of opinion, and the kind of advisors that he has are not really representing the large cross-section of opinions that the country holds. I think for a prime minister, it is extremely important that he gets the benefit of advice of a large number of those scholars who may have different opinions. The responsibility for taking a decision lies with the prime minister. It is his prerogative to decide, but after listening to the pros and cons given out by a large cross-section of scholars, I think in this they have faltered. The third and the another major issue has been that in the economy we have been slipping. This has been due to some faulty decisions. This has also been due to some bureaucratic bunglings which have taken place, like in GST and in some other issues. I think he needs to take a note. This departure of his chief economic advisor, which has some brilliant ideas, which is not always in conformity with the government's view, I think is not a good news. And he needs to have more number of people surrounding him who hold different opinions than only the drum beaters who talk of what the official position of the government is. The fourth and the most important thing which I feel is that if India is to grow, it has to grow in a number of spheres. It has to grow in a number of fields. Its foreign policy, its defense policy has to be good. It's one of the failure of the Modi government has been in the field of its Kashmir policy. The situation is Kashmir has been allowed to deteriorate when it could have been controlled much earlier, when the stone throwing started, all because of gaining some uh, all some political compulsions. It is when you are dealing with a problem like Kashmir, you cannot allow yourself to be swayed by narrow political considerations. I think this is a folly which they are trying to correct now is going to pay them very dearly. The another issue which is also important is they have failed like in all previous government in failing to modernize the armed forces. Our armed forces are today one of the worst equipped, despite having the best troops in the world. When I was commanding the United Nations forces in Ethiopia and Eritrea, I found that our troops were the best, our leaders were the best, but unfortunately our weapon systems left a lot to be desired. We were probably third or fourth worst equipped as far as weapons and system, weapon and equipment is concerned. And lastly, I would also like to mention that their handling of the armed forces per se also needs a lot of improvement. They seem to have antagonized the veterans in a big way. They seem to have also created a kind of an impression amongst the rank and file of the armed forces that probably this government is not always considering favorably the issues which affect them very dearly.
So you very well summed up everything, almost everything. You have touched the economic, you have touched the part that deals with the army. So we will also like to tell you that Lieutenant General Rajender Singh has also served as UN Force Commander for UN Peacekeeping Forces between 2004 to 2006, which is in itself is a big honor. Only a selected few people have been given that honor after the independence of India. Around 17 people have been given that honor. So talking about the nitty-gritties of armed forces, a lot has been said and written about the surgical strikes that happened last years. The video was released 5 days back approximately. How do you see whole of this exercise, the surgical strike, as well as the politicization, the acclaimed politicization of the issue, the release of videos? How do you see all these things?
As far as surgical strike is concerned, before I talk of that, let me mention one thing, that your army has always been a very professional army, and it has by and large always enjoyed a fair amount of autonomy in all regimes. I have seen from very close quarters the kind of leeway and freedom that we got under Atal Bihari Vajpayee's regime. I also saw the kind of freedom and leeway that the army got under Manmohan Singh's regime. And now I am looking from outside the kind of freedom and leeway that the army has got under Modi's regime. There has been, army has always been allowed to do what generally they feel professionally is required to be done, in a broad sense. However, the difference remains in a kind of response that you do in a particular situation. Like in Atal Bihari Vajpayee's regime, the response was quick and fierce in the form of Kargil conflict, which has brought us the gains which you all are aware of. In the times of Manmohan Singh, army got a fair amount of freedom in dealing with the militants in the valley, and the kind of environment that was created at that time was quite conducive to starting a negotiated settlement with the militants. In the times of Modi government, let me admit quite frankly that the emphasis on teaching Pakistan a lesson has certainly taken a fore. they have taken a deliberate decision to ensure that we cannot allow Pakistan to carry on in, interfering into our affairs, aiding and abetting the terrorists, and therefore have undertaken some measures both politically as also militarily, and have given a free hand to the army to undertake those measures which they deem fit to teach Pakistan a lesson without going in for a full-scale conflict. And I think this surgical strike is a step in that direction. It has been able to achieve its limited aim, which was to tell Pakistan that this much and no further. It has achieved its aim, that it has conveyed to Pakistan that we will not stop only or that our actions must not be misinterpreted to be a sign of weakness, and we will not even hesitate to cross the LC if the need be. Having said this, let me also tell you that earlier also we have had a number of, army has had a number of times operations across the LC. But they were only isolated, and they were few and separated by large or separated by quite some time. And this surgical strike was a coordinated move of crossing LC, going and striking the enemy targets or Pakistan's target and terrorists targets across the LC, and conveying to Pakistan that we will do everything which is in our power to stop this.
Sir, since after 2009, you have also been associated with the DLF Foundation. You were working in various capacities into the various domains of civilian welfare. So if you talk about the skill development, the potential that our youth has, how do you see the future growth of India in terms of economics, in terms of technology, or in terms of IT? How do you see Indian progressing forward?
You see, when I joined the DLF Foundation immediately after my retirement, I got an opportunity to formulate and also evolve a kind of strategy or a kind of objective for ourselves. Mr. K.P. Singh, the chairman of this DLF Foundation, felt that we need to do a lot for the poor and underprivileged of the country. And he also felt that we need to also not focus on too many things, but focus our activities in about three to four fields. And I also fully agreed with him. I felt that we should evolve our projects in a manner that it supplements government's effort in bringing about some change in the lives of the poor and underprivileged. So we accordingly decided that we will concentrate on three major issues. One was healthcare, that is providing facilities to the poor and underprivileged in the rural belt and in the slums of the cities. And in that field, at the time when I left, we had about 26 to 30 odd clinics working all over in various states, particularly in NCR, as also in a number of other states in the country. In addition, we also concentrated in the field of education, and this we did by promoting nurturing talent program, in which firstly we ran about 30 schools in partnership with Bharti Foundation in the rural belt of Haryana, Rajasthan, and NCR. Also, what we did was that we started a program in which we selected bright and brilliant kids at the level of sixth standard, and put them in public schools and handheld them right till the time they finish their schooling and also get a job or get admissions in professional colleges. We also did the same program for the students, bright, poor students passing out from 12th and who have a great potential to join professional colleges. And lastly, what we did was start a skill program in which the intention was to train 1 million people over next 10 years, in which a number of about 40 odd skill centers were started all over the country. The intention was that unless you skill people and get them jobs, the emphasis was on getting them jobs. So skill them in the fields in which they will get job. And our partners were told that your job doesn't finish only in skilling them. You have to also ensure and facilitate their getting a job. I think all these programs were greatly liked, and our foundation was given a Golden Peacock Award twice. Once in 2011 and second time in 2015. And after this, I was also felicitated with Lifetime Achievement Award by the ABP News, which is a matter of great honor. But I owe this all to the staff and the people of DLF Foundation who worked day and night to achieve or to contribute their bit towards progress of our country.
That sounds like a lot of achievements. So coming to our last question, we still have 11 months to go to the election. So what is one advice that you want to give to the government, one sector or one domain or up to number of domains where government needs to buckle up to work more, because 2019 is going to be a very tough fight?
Yes, 2019 is going to be a tough fight. And I feel that as far as Modi government is concerned, Modi government has all good intentions. I think its PR needs to improve. They are sounding too hawkish. They are sounding too arrogant. And I think that needs to soften a bit, little. The second thing is that the level of politics that has emerged over a period of time has to be brought down to a decent level. So if the opposition parties are not doing it, they must make a move by not resorting to those kind of things which are today the norms. That is, both sides talking about their old history. Somebody saying you are murderer of Mahatma Gandhi. Somebody saying that you are from Italy and you did emergency. And you know, those kind of things. I think both are undesirable. You talk about the policies of our country. You talk about achievements. You talk about your future plans. And I think the people of this country are wise enough to vote. It'll be a pity if a dynamic leader, an honest leader like Modi doesn't come back to power. But at the rate at which it is going, that path is very difficult. This is my personal opinion. And I feel one thing which Modi can do is to start shedding that image of being aloof, start shedding that image of being surrounded by only drum beaters and not by people having divergent views on many subjects. And lastly, he must concentrate on performance of some of his ministries which have not been doing well. Power, transport, and many other ministries of this kind are already doing well. But the need is to focus on some other ministries, particularly rural development, where I think the fruits of the programs which have been started have not really reached down to the people. But this is not a new phenomena. This used to happen even earlier. The only thing is that the beauty lies in ensuring that this happens to a greater degree. And lastly, I would like to say that Modi government must surely emphasize on Hindutva. But Hindutva doesn't mean anti-Dalit. It doesn't mean anti-Muslim. It also does not mean that you target people because promoting cow vigilante, or you target people by deliberately doing things which give a perception that you have no tolerance for certain sections of society. I think we are doing great in foreign affairs. We are doing great in our performance in economy is also started to pick up. Our performance in infrastructure development is also starting to pick up, thanks to Gadkari's ministry, and also our lives are going to change because of improvement in power, infrastructure, and improvement of availability of facilities to a large section of our people. In case Modi Sahab concentrates on some of the issues which I have said, but these are my opinions. They may or may not be correct, but these are my humble submissions to anybody who wants to take it. And I think Modi has a bright future. But he has a bright future provided he improves his image, provided he makes certain mid-course corrections which are the need of the hour.
Sure, sir. Thank you very much for this very enlightenment conversation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.